Okay. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our meeting. We are speaking today with Richard Moss. He is a product manager for AxiomSL. And as we move from VAR to expected shortfall regulation, coupled with the focus on liquidity as never before, I thought of sharing a perspective on one of the hottest regulation around the corner. Fundamental review of trading books, or FRTB. This results in a lot of efforts for banks on beefing up systems and processes, and at the same time opens up multiple career avenues for market risk professionals. Richard, welcome to our meeting, and please introduce yourself to our audience over this community.
Yeah, thank you. Hi, I'm Richard Moss. I'm the Capital Product Manager at AxiomSL here in EMEA. I recently joined Axiom, where I previously worked at Bank of America Merrill Lynch for 4 years, and prior to that I worked at Marcus Capital for 4 years, and before that I was an auditor. So I have a keen interest in the banking sector, specifically in the regulations, and how best to meet those, because I've seen it done efficiently in multiple different guises across the banks, and it really excites me to be working for Axiom here with one of the best, most efficient solutions in the regtech market.
All right. Richard, please, what are the advantages to banks that will be the first movers into the FRTB space?
So, as we all know, on December 8th, Basel pushed back the timelines for FRTB, and there has been money spent, some more than others, in the FRTB arena. But taking a step back, FRTB is one of the most expansive regulatory requirements and changes since VAR, as you mentioned. So in the last 20 years, I don't think there's ever been any specific regulation that has required the banks to look across the breadth and depth in such an intrinsic manner. And I guess the biggest advantage to the banks that are early adopters is focusing on their operating model, because that is, in order to get all the pieces together, there's many silos within FRTB, but you will be capital inefficient if you don't do this strategically. And I guess the operating model, you could talk about that for hours, but the sooner the desks reorganize themselves within a bank, this is the early adopters have that chance to reorganize, focus their budget, and make sure they're not scaling in an inefficient manner. And it allows them to focus their budgets, because I guess the budgets will have been brought back with one eye in 2022. And this allows the restructuring to start within the banks, and then they can look at implementing the rules and looking at legacy systems, looking at their migration path. Where can they save the most money, and how can they bring forward any capital savings that they're looking at by reorganizing for FRTB? So the sooner they adopt, the more they can take advantages of that reorganization, of that restructure, and look at risk management and capital management together for the first time, because they're often and still are separate things.
All right, thank you. Richard, there is a school of thought suggesting that banks can most easily cope with the demands of FRTB by simply adding hardware. Are you agree with this?
I agree to an extent. So FRTB does obviously require an increased computational power. There's nobody arguing that, but it simply isn't enough, and it's not sustainable just to increase GPU or grid computational power. The challenge is that you have to remain compliant to BCBS 239. So it had the growth of hardware and software and tech infrastructure has to be scalable for future business growth. So FRTB does demand a much larger scale of computation, purely because SBA has to be calculated for every desk across the bank. No model risk factors have to be calculated under various stress scenarios. and the layered expected shortfall and partial ES could be up to 63 calculations daily, and elements of that could be run weekly. So there's no doubt that it does demand an increase in computational power that could be delivered from hardware, but the solution and the scalability has to be there, which means that the calculations have to be performed in a way that doesn't generate waste. And ideally, the best way to do this is through a risk factor dependency-driven instrument revaluation, so you can always source your dependencies in terms of risk factors to get a full revaluation, and then you get the consistency and the commonality across disks by product. But in order to achieve that, you have to have the taxonomies in place. You have to have the standard referential reference data in place, and that is where all the legwork is. So if you put that hard legwork in, you'll get the benefits of a more efficient full revaluation.
All right. What do you see as the long-term ramification of the FRTB for banks and financial institutions?
So I think there's two sides to this. The ramifications or the actual effect is an increase in transparency ultimately, and that's what the regulators try. That is the intent, to increase transparency and reduce the nuances that exist within banks internally, across desks and across banks, as the regulator is obviously looking across the street. In terms of the other side, internally, ramifications and long-term effects, is a shift towards risk. What I mean by that is that currently, if you look at the regulations within a bank, you will have a reg team, so a reg finance team, and then which would kind of sit in the same area geographically as the finance team, and then you'd have the front office and middle office and the risk function completely different in different silos. But FRTB is merging these two things together. You'll see the capital spikes, you'll see inconsistencies, you'll start failing the various tests. And this raises the question about what is the future long-term job, if you like, of the risk, of the reg function, and should it actually be part of risk? I think the answer is yes, it should be part of risk, but does that mean there's a new function that appears in the long term, like a business partner that helps the front office maintain business growth but monitors risk and capital management? Or does it mean that the reg experts or the reg finance team have to become more savvy and educated in modeling and risk factors? So we're not dealing with a balance sheet anymore that's driven by assets and liabilities and notionals. We're talking about a balance sheet that has to go right through to the risk factor level, and therefore the booking model and the desk structure, right back to trader mandates. And this is something that reg finance wouldn't be comfortable with in the current world. But in the long term, if they want to remain in that function, then they're the types of areas that they need to go and increase their expertise and skills in.
All right. Thank you. What would you advise to a chief technology officer or CTO who is embarking on this journey?
If I'm a CTO and I looked at FRTB, I think I'd be rubbing my hands together, because it's the first time a regulation is actually, it's not driven by the CFO, or not necessarily, I mean, the CRO has an involvement here, but This is a data problem. The challenge created by FRTB is truly the sheer scale of data, and if there are any inconsistencies across the bank, it has an impact on capital and it has an impact on risks. So we're talking about the CFO and CRO are therefore interested. But ultimately, to meet this the increased demand and scale, it has to be a technology-led solution to deal with the true volumes of data. So it's more of an opportunity to take the lead, and it becomes looking at the data, but also you're building on the foundation, the building blocks of BCBS 239, So there's current estimates of in the street of around $7 billion and counting from the BCBS implementation. Now, that's going to continue. So these best practice guidelines will become almost punitive, if not met, via the increased spike in capital charges. And therefore, under FRTB, when we're talking about pricing in capital, you will lose your competitive advantage if you don't remain true to and compliant to BCBS 239. And it's only the vision and transformation projects that the CTO would own that allows BCBS 239 to still be applied. So in the future, maybe when we're talking about the end of FRTB implementation in 2027 after the rollout phase, the regulator will probably no longer be submitted to. They will have their own data model, which should be aligned standard to a standard data model. And they are likely to be looking to pull data elements and data points, so they have true transparency and visibility of all the data they need, which means that you have to implement this in a scalable way. So for me, this brings the CTO to the front and center. And it's a question of ownership. I think ownership still sits with the CFO and CIO in terms of capital and risk, but there's a responsibility from the CTO in FRTB and a real chance to drive this implementation.
All right. Thank you. Many banks are headed in the direction of having the front office and risk on the same platform. What are your thoughts on this? On that?
I think it's true. It is true. Either two things have to. Either we have to, the banks will have to conform all of their processes, which are currently in silos. So, for whatever reason, in the industry, individual tech stacks have grown up through merger, through acquisitions, through growth, through new technology, and the fact that the front office has always had a larger budget than, say, risk, middle office, finance. So for that reason, the front office systems are normally better equipped in terms of calculation power, speed, and the actual data feeds that they get can be real-time rather than once a month or weekly or daily. So there's many reasons why these two things have become two separate silos, but there's also a reason why they should be different, because risk had more time to look back historically and come up with a more accurate answer in terms of how to manage risk and for a specific risk purpose, whereas front office want to be able to mark their books to accurately price deals, and they've got their own agenda. However, I do agree that having the same or sharing the same systems and technology it is an advantage, but the difficulty, the challenge is bringing together the two processes. These sit in two completely different worlds. They have a different agenda. And at the top of this call, when I talked about early adopters getting used to their operating model, this would become part of it. So when you look across products traded currently across different desks that might be structured by market segment or the type of business activity that they conduct, if you're trading the same product, it should be marked the same across each individual system. And obviously that's better. You can do that much easily the fewer systems that you have. So this is a chance to get rid of the outliers, the legacy systems where and this is common practice throughout the industry, where a product would be booked in a certain system in order for it to price correctly. It works as a process. You can still manage the risk, but it causes inefficiencies when you want to look across the different processes and apply adjustments and look at which model is most efficient, which ones to use, which ones could I potentially let go, which is all part of the operating model being driven by FRTB. So, there are benefits, obviously, to risk being aligned to front office. But it's much easier said than done in practice because of the way the banks have grown up.
All right. Thank you. What then are challenges of FRTB for banks with multiple platforms?
The main challenge if they have multiple platforms, for me, is one of risk and governance. As the Basel papers become finalised and the consultation papers become more well-read in those parts of Trodden, the things that seem to be chasing up when there's no regulatory change are just the guidelines for risk and governance compliance. So if you look at the new Pillar 2 guidelines and the increased SREP guidelines about having a framework for proving risk and governance over your models, having a structure, a sign-off in place, and something that is transparent and attestable, that becomes increasingly difficult with the more platforms that you have. So find a structure and a framework in terms of supervisory review and having a good story for the regulators when if they were to come and have a look at what your BCBS 239 implementation looks like or your stress testing framework. All of this has to be aligned, and it makes it very difficult if you've got multiple platforms. And that's from a control perspective, but from a day-to-day tech implementation, if you have different systems, they have their nuances. And a product that is exactly the same thing could be named one thing in one system and a completely different thing in another system. And the people and the users get used to that and accept it. That just makes it very difficult to look across the practices and align those things to a data model. And FRTB and SACA and the new leverage ratio rules, everything is becoming more standardized with credible standard models. And this just gives you a flavor of where the regulators are going. They're moving towards being completely transparent and open. And so then the data is just completely common. And the best way to achieve that is to have one solution and one platform that can deal with multiple data inputs and normalize and harmonize it in a way that allows it to be scalable. And that means that you can then run scenarios and what-if analysis and look at your cash flow generation and really look at that return on equity underneath of these different organizational structures. So it's a real true benefit to be able to have one platform with multiple data feeds, rather than having to maintain the connections and the communication across siloed infrastructures. It's one of the main challenges in the banks, and it's not easy to fix at all, but there are solutions out there that absolutely make this path a lot easier.
All right. Thank you, Richard. And maybe last question. What are the biggest mistakes you see in the process of implementation this regulation?
I think racing ahead before, I mean, I know that the consultation papers and the final rules have been around for a while, but there were so many questions being raised in all of the QIS studies that were heavily participated in. Some banks have thrown money at the problem to see what they can get, rather than thinking from the bottom up. They've tried to look top down, and just FRTB requires stripping things back to basics and thinking about how you would solve this from a data solution, which is what I said earlier. If you think about this in terms of data rather than regulations, you get to a much better, more achievable goal. It might take a bit longer. In the long run, you will probably likely end up spending less money. So there's been a lot of expense in terms of looking at reorganization, looking at who should own what, doing the analysis of just being scared by the output floor when there were estimates between 70% and 90%. I think some of the mid-tier banks were just already jumping straight to say we're just going to be fully standardized and we will let go of our models. So I think underneath the timelines of this study, some of that is reasonable, but some of that cost is now a sunk cost and you can't regain some of that. So I think the costless mistakes are not taking this back to what it's driven by, and that's taking it back to the data. And the ownership of the data and how you would restructure those things.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Richard. I think we finished our interview. And...